Welcome, one and all, to the mystical world of Feltbar. Adventures abound throughout this realm, and we appreciate the opportunity to regale you with some stories from these trails. These accounts are all based on actual RPG experiences that occurred within Adventures in Feltbar. Some of these tales may be for mature audiences, while others may be for very immature audiences. We now present the sage Mikus Tumo from Tumel, also known as the Bard of Feltbar.
Welcome to Session Denali 47. When last we listened, the group had met Grisha's charming associate, Captain Apair, and had gotten more rest. The following morning, they were alerted that a ship of green guardsmen were landing, and they needed to beat a hasty retreat from Tigos Vale. After picking up Phidias from the witch on the edge of town, they made their final push to the swamp, where King Pellet had originated from. We rejoin them now as they look at the overgrown ruins at the edge of the murky water. "Looks like no one has lived here in decades," stated Sir Omel, Knight of Bacchus. The others nodded in agreement, and Grish looked puzzled. "I was just here 3 years ago with Pellet, and this was a thriving community. I do not understand this at all," he said. Phidias poked around several spots and jumped back, causing everyone to draw their weapons. The gnome put up his hand for everyone to hold and reached down into some overgrowth. "Nothing to worry about," he stated, retrieving a small blue snake from a hole. "It's just a little snake." He proudly held it aloft to show everyone his prize. Yolanda and Grish gasped when they saw it, while the others shook their heads. "Phidias?" Grish started in a low tone. "That is an aquafang, and it is very poisonous." Yolanda added, "There is no known cure. Slowly toss it to one side." Brother Stance, Harris the Mage, and Sir Omel moved forward but were told to remain still. The ever-curious gnome looked at the snake as it flicked its tongue in and out and began to chuckle. "But it's so pretty!" He moved in to pet it and had to jerk his hand away several times as the deadly viper attempted to strike him. After several moments of the cat-and-mouse game, he spun it over his head and tossed it into a small sack at his waist. "I'll keep it for later," he proudly announced as the others exhaled deeply. A dispute broke out between Grish and Phidias as to keeping possession of the deadly snake, but the rogue was quite adamant about his position. It wasn't until Brother Stance announced that he had found a trail that the argument ceased. The group gathered around the opening to the swamp and noticed it was not pronounced, but it was clearly a trail leading into the dank darkness. Each member looked at each other and nodded, with Grish plunging in first. Sunlight permeated the canopy, and strange sounds filled the area as the party moved deeper and deeper into the bog. The trail ended several feet into it, and according to Grish, he believes the answer will be found near the center. Phidias complained loudly that the good stuff is always in the center, and never on the edge, where it is easier to get, but he was told to hush, as he would attract things if he didn't shut up. 15 minutes into the murky investigation, the group found themselves in water up to the gnome's waist, who pointed out that his pet snake did not enjoy the changing weather. Again, he was chastised for fiddling with the serpent in the first place. As the debate grew heated, Grish stopped in the brackish water and ordered Phidias to pitch the snake. The anger etched upon his face gave everyone a cause for concern, and it was clear that he meant what he said. A dejected Phidias slowly reached for the bag, but his blood ran cold and he froze in place as he looked in the cleric's direction. Seeing the rogue stopped only angered Grish more, but he was quickly knocked sideways as he moved towards Phidias. Looking up from his fallen position, he observed that Sir Omel had knocked him over and was battling an 8-foot collection of plants shaped like a humanoid. Yolanda and Stance quickly stepped over the cleric to aid the knight, and Harris fired off several blasts of magic, which seemed to do no harm to the plant creature. The monster grabbed Brother Stance as he attempted martial arts and stuffed the monk's head into the ivy-covered chest causing the member of the Vertae Order to struggle weakly. Grish attempted to crawl over to the beast, but took a foot to the head and his face went underwater, causing him to struggle, just like Brother Stan's. Phidias leaped, hitting the plant creature squarely in the torso, and yelled for everyone to clear away. The leafy vines began to reach into the center of the body, forgetting all about Stance and Grish, who were sputtering for breath as they were being dragged away. Smoke began to emit from the tendrils, and the creature quickly withered into the murky water. Everyone turned to Phidias with a questioning look. With hands on his hips, the gnome had a smug look on his face before coughing and taking a professional approach. "While it's Arcona's," he began, "I noticed a vial of poison. When I spoke with her about it, she confirmed it was used to strip the life out of plants. I assumed that it would work against that thing," he continued, to extol the virtues of borrowing things until he deftly leaned against an old mossy stone, but stopped as a foggy green orb rose from the waters and circled the party. Everyone looked on in bewilderment, and the orb split into two different orbs. The group was dumbfounded and looked on wordlessly until the orbs struck Harris the Mage and Grish the Cleric, enveloping them into a much larger bubble. As they attempted to break out, a shriek was heard, and a spindly green woman jumped atop the mossy stone and spit something at Sir Omel from a hollow tube. The warrior reached for his neck, where a small barb was stuck, but his body went rigid and he fell backwards into the water. The weight of his armor began to drag him under quickly. Stance and Yolanda assumed defensive posture as the woman kicked Phidias in the side of the head, knocking him over as well. Brother Stance jumped up with a flying kick, but the elderly woman was too quick and pushed him out of the way in midair, sending him into a thicket of needle brushes. Yolanda gave out a warrior yell, swinging both swords at the crone. As her blades hit the fiend's arm, sparks flew off, and no damage was accrued. The hag quickly kicked Yolanda twice between the legs and kneed her in the face as she doubled over in pain. She was flung backwards into the water and also began to sink. The night hag quickly spun around, facing off with Phidias, who fumbled through the water for his daggers that he had dropped. She waggled an overgrown fingernail at him. You look good enough to eat, little one. Time for a taste," she said. As she reached for him, a recovered Stance jumped on her back and attempted to choke her out. She responded by doubling over and smashing the monk's face back into a tree, causing him to fall unconscious, face down in the water. Turning back to the gnome, she cackled loudly and spat out, "Where were we? Oh yes, yunch!" Phidias began to sputter and begged for his life. "I'll give you my magic gems. You can have them all," he stated. The hag laughed and grabbed her belly, nearly doubling over. "Gnome, I will take everything you and your friends have after I kill you. Tell me, what do your magic stones do?" A look of fear crossed the rogue's face as he shook his head from side to side. "You don't know, do you, stupid little creature?" she muttered as she grabbed the small sack held by Phidias. "You are a stupid, stupid creature. I can tell you what the magic does, and I will show you how stupid you are." Phidias watched intently as the hag opened the bag, releasing the aqua snake, which quickly bit into the fiend's eye. Blood gushed from the wound as she flailed about in pain and pulled the snake off with her eye included in its mouth. The snake went limp, as did the hag. The snake quickly regained itself and looked around and spotted the gnome. Fear gripping the diminutive man, he diminished as the snake slid along onto the top of the water and moved deeper into the swamp. The green globes holding Harris and Grish popped, depositing both into the water. Each member of the trio ran to a fallen comrade and pulled their heads above the quagmire and moved them to higher ground to offer aid.
We close out this episode now and give you our thanks for listening. Please subscribe to this podcast. And don't forget to follow us on Twitter at The Bards Podcast. For everyone in Adventures of Philbar, thanks for listening.